Hey guys, JohnnyKerbs2000 here, and welcome to my Let's Play of Dead or Alive 4 for the Xbox 360. Now this game was released way back in December of 2005. It was one of the first games that was released on the Xbox 360, although, interestingly enough, it wasn't released as a launch title the same way that Dead or Alive 3 had been for the original Xbox. Although I do remember getting this game at launch, mainly because I didn't get the Xbox 360 at launch. I got it maybe for my birthday. My birthday's in March. But this game, I think I have some memories with this game because I got this game along with Marvel Ultimate Alliance. Those two were the first games that I ever got for the Xbox 360. So I have some sort of sentimental attachment to this game, though that's not really saying much, as I'll soon kind of get to why that is in a minute here. But it was rather interesting. At first, before I did my research for this Let's Play, before coming on here and doing my little commentary here, I could have sworn that this was a launch title, but apparently it wasn't. So there you go. And here we are seeing the intro movie. As always, Dead or Alive has some of the best intros of any fighting game. Pretty much of any game, really. I know I keep stressing that, but really, though, I mean, these are some high-quality visuals here. The interesting thing, though, about this intro, as opposed to all the other intros that we've seen so far in the Dead or Alive series that I've covered, is that this intro actually doesn't play on its own, like the same way that the intros for Dead or Alive 3 and Dead or Alive Ultimate have, in that, you know, those intros pretty much just played as soon as you start up the game. This one, you actually have to wait at the press start menu, at the press start screen, and then wait a bit before it comes on. And I have no idea why. It's the only one that does that. I think Dead or Alive 5 also does that, but it's still, you know, it's still a bit strange to me. Especially since, as I mentioned, these, you know, these look pretty damn awesome. I mean, this one in particular isn't one of my favorites. I still prefer the one from Dead or Alive Ultimate and Dead or Alive 3. I think one of the reasons why I don't particularly like this one isn't so much the action going on, because it's still pretty damn awesome. But I think the song that was used in both Dead or Alive 3 and Dead or Alive Ultimate, I just prefer. The song that you're probably hearing right now, if you can hear it over my loud voice, is Eat the Rich from Aerosmith. So continuing on with the theme of always using a song by Aerosmith, I really couldn't tell you why they always use Aerosmith, other than Aerosmith is pretty awesome. It might also be that Itagaki, the director of the Dead or Alive series up until this point, he may be a fan of Aerosmith. I'm not exactly sure. To me, it might be the reason why, especially since if you've ever seen him, if you know Itagaki the way that, you know, that I've known him throughout the series, he's kind of a bit of a he's got kind of like a rock star personality going on. He always has, you know, sunglasses everywhere he goes. He always has a black jacket on, black leather jacket on. So I really wouldn't be surprised that getting Aerosmith to provide the music for every single Dead or Alive game up until this point was his decision. I mean, he is the director, but I'm pretty sure he has a big influence as far as getting the music from Aerosmith involved. And anyway, we are introduced here to a brand new character. This game introduced, let's see, four new characters. Three new characters that have since become staples in the Dead or Alive series. So starting with this game going forward, and one new character, actually five new characters including the boss character here. But one character is an exclusive to this game, and you will never find her in any other Dead or Alive series, or any other Dead or Alive game, rather, ever again after this one. The new characters include Kokoro, who was the girl that we just saw there, the Japanese girl. And we have Elliot, and we have La Mariposa, who is the character that I'm going to be using for this Let's Play. And then you also have the boss character of... God, I can't remember her name. It's Alpha 152, I think. And then you also have another secret character, which I won't mention right now, but I will be talking about her a little bit later on. But as you guys can see here, we've moved on to the 360, so we have a lot better visuals Honestly, though, they still look sort of similar to the visuals of Dead or Alive Ultimate, but obviously they're in HD. They're a lot more crisp. They look a little bit more flashy. The shading is definitely is showing off some nice polish here, especially on Hayabusa's outfit there. But for the most part, it's the same old Dead or Alive series. This game is very similar to Dead or Alive 3 and Dead or Alive Ultimate with one huge difference, which is something that I'll get to in a minute here. But this is Dead or Alive 4. You guys see there, nice little Las Vegas themed background. And we are going to go to Dead or Alive 4 story mode. And here we will see all of the characters here. Now, you may notice that Helena is in the middle. She's very prominent there, and the reason why is because she's actually an unlockable character, interestingly enough. As you guys see there, you may also notice that some characters are not present. So, to start things off, the characters that have been taken away, so as soon as you boot up your copy of Dead or Alive 4, you may notice that some characters are missing. Now, we have added three new characters to the mix there, as I mentioned before, Kokoro, Elliot, and La Mariposa. But when you first start off your game, you'll notice that Helena, Leon, Ian, and Genfu are not part of the lineup. In fact, Genfu is not in this thing, or Genfu or Ian are not part of this lineup here. Genfu being the old man and Ian being the alternate, I guess, the alter ego of Hayate. Well, Ian, since Dead or Alive 2, he's never been a selectable character again in the main storyline, so he makes sense. Genfu, on the other hand, it was established in Dead or Alive 3 that he has since kind of retired from fighting since he's gotten the money to cure his granddaughter. So he's no longer here. He has been replaced, though, by Elliot, which is the blonde guy at the sort of like at the bottom right there, who shares some of his moves and shares the same fighting style. And Helena and Leon, for some reason, were taken out. They can be unlocked, as you guys saw there. For some reason, they made him an unlockable character. And as you guys can see here, Genfu, you can play him in the story mode. However, you can't play as him in the story mode because he doesn't really have a story, per se. But anyway, we are playing as La Mariposa, which is one of my favorite fighting characters of all time. I know that's sort of like a big thing to say, but really, though, she is a lot of fun. She has a very eclectic style. It's a mixture between capoeira and lucha libre, which is one of the most interesting mixtures of styles that I have personally ever seen in my life, both from a video game standpoint and from a real life martial arts standpoint. It's a very, very crazy mixture of styles, and the outcome is a very, very sort of high energy, very acrobatic, very eclectic style, I guess. And again, here we see Leon as well, two of the characters that are not selectable in the story mode, but they can still show up to fight against you. But these characters are only available in the time attack mode, and that's how you unlock some of their stuff. One of the things that I mentioned before, one of the main reasons why this game I don't particularly find to be one of my favorites has to do with the gameplay mechanics. And you'll notice right away that I just got my ass kicked by Leon, which normally doesn't happen. Leon is normally one of the tougher enemies, especially because he's very counter-friendly. He's very, he counters a lot of your moves and he grabs you, so you have to really be careful when getting near him. But in general, Dead or Alive 4 is a lot harder. For some reason, they upped the difficulty by a noticeable amount. In fact, this is the most difficulty I've had in any of my Let's Plays so far in the entire Dead or Alive series, and I was dreading playing this game because of it. Now, this has to do with a couple of new things. The gameplay, for the most part, hasn't changed all that much from Dead or Alive 3 and Dead or Alive Ultimate. There have been some changes done. For example, the most common thing for fighting games is that the characters have new moves, or new characters, new backgrounds, and things like that. Some of the stages, in fact, have some obstacles. There's one stage that takes place in sort of like a park with dinosaurs, and you can actually jump over fallen logs and things like that. But for the most part, the most drastic change that has taken place here, going from Dead or Alive Ultimate to Dead or Alive 4, has been the counter system. The counter system has been tightened dramatically, and because of that, the difficulty of this game, as I mentioned before, has been upped a very, very noticeable amount. This is the hardest time that I've had with a Dead or Alive game since the first Dead or Alive game, which, you know, admittedly was probably difficult, not necessarily because of my own fault. It was more so because of the gameplay's fault. The controls weren't as tightened or weren't as tight as they needed to be. But for this game, I really don't know why the difficulty was raised to such an amount. The counter system has been tightened, meaning that the window of opportunity to counter moves has been made even smaller. So that means you have to be way more accurate with your countering now than ever before. Otherwise, you won't counter. You have to be really precise. You have to really hit the counter button at just the right time in order to be able to counter. At the same time, though, for some reason, the computer can counter you all the freaking time. In fact, you'll see it a lot of times. I actually had to edit out a lot of the deaths or a lot of the KOs that a lot of the matches that I lost. I won't do that, however, with my fight against Hayate, and I won't do that for the final boss. Just so you guys can see just how bad the difficulty can get in this game. It's a very noticeable amount, as you guys will soon see. But other than that, it's the same exact game. Obviously, it's a little bit faster, as you guys can probably tell. The stages are way more elaborate. In fact, this one in particular is one of my favorites. You know, you hear the crowd cheering. The ropes are electrified. In fact, La Mariposa has this one really cool move, as you guys probably noticed in the intro, where she can actually climb the ropes and then jump off of them. I personally don't know how to do it, so you won't see me doing it here. But pretty cool. In fact, here we go. I lost to Hayabusa pretty decisively, and I'm just mashing the counter button here over and over again. But again, I'm not countering because the countering system has been tightened to a certain degree, where countering just isn't as how should I say it? Countering a move in this game isn't as assured as it used to be, meaning that even if you press the counter button, you aren't really it's not a sure bet that you're going to be countering any moves. And the computer, the CPU AI has definitely been upped. It makes for a more annoying game overall, but it's still Dead or Alive. You can still have some fun. I probably would, if this is going to be your first Dead or Alive game, I would suggest lowering the difficulty to maybe easy, because otherwise you're gonna have a really, really hard time, especially with the boss character, who is one of the more difficult fighting characters that I've personally ever faced off against. Oh, this is a good example. Watch this. I remember this because this was so annoying. Look at that first move, and she countered. I am not going to land a single hit on Lei Fang, and that has never happened to me. Look at that. Holy crap. That's how hard this game is, folks. But anyway, I will go ahead and enough talk about the difficulty. You guys will just see it for yourselves here. You guys can make the decision here of how difficult this game is. But one thing that I did want to talk about is the other new character that was introduced in this game, and the more exclusive character that was introduced in this game. I say exclusive because she was introduced in this game, and she has since never appeared again in a Dead or Alive game. She wasn't in Dead or Alive 5, she wasn't in Dead or Alive Dimensions for the 3DS, and it's a surefire bet that she won't appear again in any other Dead or Alive game after this. That character is called Spartan 458, who, as the name suggests, is actually a Spartan from the Halo universe. Her name is actually Nicole, but she's known as Spartan 458. To kind of keep in line with the theme of Spartans being named by a different, I guess, code number from the Halo series. So she's actually from the Halo series. And the way you unlock her is if you beat story mode using Helena, after obviously unlocking Helena. And she's actually a pretty cool character, although her moves may not be as fun as you may want them to be. She's rather slow, and she plays very similarly to Leon and Bayman. So you can, if you remember how those two guys fight, then you kind of get an idea of how she plays. But she does have some pretty cool moves and pretty cool... she brings some cool additions to the series. One of them being that you actually get to play in her stage, which takes place in the Nassau station, which is a level from the Halo series, which is pretty cool. Before I continue here, I'm not cutting out any of the KOs that I suffered from this match, just so you guys can see what a typical match in Dead or Alive 4 looks like. I am just getting all kinds of owned by Hayate. And again, I'm not going to edit out any deaths so you guys can see how long it actually took me to beat this guy. But anyway, she does have Spartan 458, does have some pretty interesting moves. By doing her taunt, you can actually invoke her invisibility cloak, which is actually a move that you can do in Halo Reach. And you can also go into invisibility by collecting an invisibility cloak in most of the Halo games. So that's one of her moves, though honestly I don't know how well you'd be able to use that since this is a fighting game, so you kind of have to know where you are. But I suppose that in a versus game against a human opponent, it may come in handy. Either that or just provide a couple laughs between you and your buddy. And personally, one of my more fun moves to do when I'm playing as Spartan 458 is this grab move where she actually grabs you. She takes out a sticky grenade from her... well, I really don't know where she gets it from. She takes a sticky grenade, she uppercuts your stomach, she attaches the sticky grenade onto you, and she kicks you away, and the sticky grenade actually explodes. And it looks all kinds of awesome. So again, she does bring some pretty... she's not just a clone of Leon and Bayman. She does actually bring some pretty awesome moves to her. And finally, we are able to take out Hayate here. Like I said, guys, this game is pretty damn tough. And now we are going to be introduced to Alpha 152, who is actually, if you guys remember way back in Dead or Alive 2, we actually, if you played the story mode in Dead or Alive 2 as a Kasumi, you encountered a Kasumi clone. Or if you didn't, there was a stage where I actually had a bunch of Kasumi clones in test tubes and things like that. Alpha 52 is one of those Kasumi clones, except she's sort of, I guess, gone haywire. This is like Kasumi clone to the 13th power. By the way, I have no idea what's going on here in this section here. I can't remember his name, but we see him, and it was just kind of like, what the... I was thinking the same thing. I haven't played this game in a while since before recording this, and I was just like, what the hell does this have to do with La Mariposa? And now we are fighting Alpha 152, who is quite possibly one of the harder... I'm just going to go and flat out say that she's probably the hardest enemy in the entire Dead or Alive series. I haven't played Dead or Alive 5 all that much yet. In fact, I'm still going through the story mode, so you may not see my Let's Play of Dead or Alive 5 for a while, unfortunately. But I can safely say that Alpha 152 is definitely one of the harder enemies that I've ever encountered. And she can definitely be a pain with certain characters, especially some of the slower characters like Bass and Genfu and things like that, and you know, guys like that. Because she has certain moves, you probably already noticed them right away. She has a teleport move that pretty much serves as her counter move. So if she counters one of your moves, she can either counter it outright, so counter it with one of her own moves, or she'll just teleport away from you and behind you, and then she'll attack you like that. She also has this other really annoying move where she kicks you just a bunch of times, like 5, 6, 7 hit combos right away, and can take a lot of damage away from you. Surprisingly enough, though, I actually did pretty well in my run here. I was very lucky that it didn't take more than the amount of times that it did for this playthrough. But normally, it would take me a lot longer to beat Alpha 152. And there we go. Just got beat. I almost got her, and then I got beat. Damn it. But that's just pretty much what you have to do here. You always have to just, you really have to be on your type game, especially with the counters, which is the way that I end up beating her, is with counters. Just I was very lucky with a bunch of counters here, as you guys can see here. And those counters actually take up a lot of damage. So As you guys can see there, one counter took off a considerable amount of damage from her, which is the route that I would suggest going with. And we were lucky enough, we beat Alpha 152, and now we get to see the ending movie here. Oh my. This doesn't look... And we are introduced to La Mariposa with her swiveling hips and swiveling chest. As always, this is Dead or Alive, so we do get a bunch of fan service. And we are actually told a rather interesting piece of information about our little La Mariposa here, as we will soon see. These three fat guys beating up on our girl Tina there. Tina, of course, being the girl that we played as in Dead or Alive Ultimate, so they're not going to get away with it. And kukukush. How she's able to all of a sudden weigh a bunch like that to be able to take out three fairly muscular guys, I have no idea. And what's this? And look who it is! It's actually Lisa, who we were introduced to in Dead or Alive Extreme Beach Volleyball. If you guys haven't seen my Let's Play of it, shameless plug, go check out my YouTube channel. I actually did an entire Let's Play of Dead or Alive Extreme Beach Volleyball. Go check it out! And that is one hell of a German suplex. I tip my hat off to you. And one of the interesting things here, guys, is that we actually don't get to see a proper credits screen. I don't know why. I actually tried to check it out, to see why it didn't show. As you guys can see here, I actually go to the movie theater, or the theater mode, to check to see if we can actually see the credits. Because unlike previous Dead or Alive games, we don't get a credits screen. We only get nothing, really. Which is a shame, because we actually, the ending credits to this game are actually pretty cool. We actually get to see a really cinematic type looking credits sequence with the song Amazing from Aerosmith playing in the background. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a way to play it, so sorry. So anyway, guys, that's it for me. That has been Dead or Alive 4. It's a tough as hell as a game, but it's a good Dead or Alive game. It's not necessarily one of my favorite ones. Unfortunately, the difficulty really kills it for me, and the Titan counter system really makes this game really hard to play, but you can still find some fun, especially if you get somebody to play along with you. And La Mariposa definitely makes this game a lot of fun. She's a lot of fun to play. One of my favorite characters to play from any fighting game. So that's it for me, guys. That's it. This has been Johnny Crimson 2000, and I will see you in my next video. All right, peace out. As always, if you like this video, be sure to hit that like button and subscribe to my channel if you want to get more stuff from me. In the meantime, if you like my videos, be sure to find me on Twitter, Tumblr, Raptr, and Screwattack.com to see the other gaming-related content that I upload. Info is in the description. Who knows? Maybe you'll like my stuff. Maybe. Maybe.